I didn't have any help. And I don't know why I got a stuffed swan in covered in plastic. I have no idea. I mean, do you have any idea?
I remember seeing it and just being amazed at how much someone could charge for doing an album cover. It was like £1,000 or something. Or, you know, it was outrageous.
I mean, everybody was up in arms about it, really. I think it's still, they still are. I think they still hate the sight of it. I think it's grown quite famously big for being an awful cover, I think. Goodness knows what was going on at the time.
General music industry was surprised because of the success of the band and being totally electronic.
People were about to enter the guitar wars, where it was the death of the guitar, and Depeche were one of the bands that were, you know, supposedly heralding the death of the guitar.
And it was just for some reason, we seemed to be perceived in the wrong way, and people didn't take us as seriously as maybe Heaven 17 or maybe the Human League or some of those bands, which was very depressing because the band I cared the most about was Depeche.
There was so much pressure to be credible in one respect and also be a chart act. And initially they were very nervous of and continue to be, for quite a while, nervous of the press and what press would do to them.
Kind of did change everything. It was a huge record. It went on the radio after a struggle, but it went on the radio. And the boys then broke the mold. We got Top of the Pops. It all started to happen. And I think, you know, for the process of New Life, I think the band were loving every second of it. You know, it was exciting. They were having a hit record, and we had an album to come shortly on the back of that. And it was kind of getting to the point where, yeah, we're happening. This is all developing in the right direction.
I was actually on Top of the Pops when I was still at work.
I was treated as a hero when I walked in the next day, because that's in the days when Top of the Pops was really, really popular. Yeah. And so I think I was doing my mum's notice.
I remember not sleeping the night before, you know, which seems ridiculous now, you know, but, you know, again, we were really young and it was a programme that you grew up with.
There was a bit of fear because I think that New Life was like at number 11, and Martin said to Daniel Miller, you know, do you really think we've got to give up our day jobs? And Daniel had to say, yeah, I think you're safe now.
I called my office. I said, look, if I get on the Concorde, I just have a hunch about this. If I get on the Concorde and come over, can you guys pick me up and take me to Basildon? And I said, you know where it is. It's right off the 81, you know, which of course it wasn't. But they knew where it was, fortunately. And at least I had the town right. And I saw them.
We were really shocked that someone from New York would bother coming all the way to Basildon to see us.
At that point, there were similar bands around, but I don't know how you could watch them for an hour without falling asleep. Depeche Mode were the first of those bands that were so fucking great live that it was just amazing.
They were a band who were prepared to work hard, and I didn't want to waste their time with useless shows, but at the same time, I felt that to have a lot of shows in the calendar was always good.
People were coming with a sort of strange expectation because they were going to see probably one of their first shows where there hadn't been a band actually playing, you know, conventional instruments on stage. So I think people had a sort of strange expectation about what they were going to see. We were certainly a bit surprised about it because we hadn't done a show with a band that didn't have a drummer, and, you know, in some ways it was quite a simplistic sort of setup, wasn't it?
Yeah, but also it was harder in a way because you haven't got the visuals of a drummer and people behind keyboards are restricted. So much was on Dave's shoulders that he used to have to really work the crowd. And it was obviously the music, but also the live side, the way it picked up the reputation of being such a good night, because he had the famous saying, "And you up there," didn't he? Because when he used to play Hammersmith Odeon, he used to include the balcony and just about everyone in there, and it was amazing.
But it was also from those days. I don't know if it was a fact that they were sort of, you know, a band together in uniformity, but I mean, he was never one of those guys who would talk to the audience. You know, it would be like, you know, "Come on, get going," or "You up there," or whatever, but it's never the long chats in between the shows, which has carried on all the way through, really. He's never been a vocal person on stage, apart from
he doesn't crack one-liners, does he?
No, not like us. He never listened to us, did he?
By October, they're doing a very serious national tour. They play Newcastle, Edinburgh, Manchester, Birmingham, Nottingham, Liverpool, Sheffield, Bristol, Basildon, dear Basildon, Reckells, Brighton, Poole, Leicester, and two nights at the Lyceum. And actually, talking of memories, those two nights at the Lyceum were awesome. And I remember pulling the promoter and the hall manager into the venue and pointing at the rear balcony and saying, "Can you see how much that balcony is moving?" Because it was bouncing up and down, because the kids were bouncing up and down. That was two ram shows. Huge success.
I don't think we were really thinking in past the next gig, actually. The only time it started wearing on me was when we did the last tour, when I did the last tour with them.
Do you think that the band will look the same in another 2 years with only synths?
If you come back in 2 years' time, then you can say, "I don't think we're going to change it." You never know, though. You know, we might change in a week's time, but who knows?